for the Susan Taylor Podcast, where we discuss the yoga of mind, medicine, and healing. Author of Feeling Good Matters, Sexual Radiance, and the Vital Energy Program, Dr. Taylor imparts authentic knowledge and practical tools that inspire, educate, and empower us to be a healing force for positive change. So join us and take your life and our planet to the next level.
Hello and welcome to episode 36. Top superfoods, is it hype or reality? What is a superfood? And are the claims necessarily true? Today I'll talk about superfoods, what is meant by them and what is meant by the term, and talk about some foods that can be classified accordingly. In fact, my three favorites. So let's get started. Is there such thing as a superfood? Many claim that there are. The term superfood has been used to describe practically every natural food and health food item in the past few years on the market. With the term's constant use and misuse, of course, in advertising, food marketing, and the media, there's so much confusion and unfounded claims surrounding these superfoods. Keep in mind that the term isn't regulated and can be attributed to practically anything. And that's a fact that many big-name food product manufacturers do indeed exploit. And while the term superfood has been used as a marketing tactic with false promises many times, it is a real concept. In fact, the Oxford Dictionary defines a superfood as a nutrient-rich food considered to be especially beneficial for health and well-being. But that doesn't mean superfoods should be treated as the remedy to cure all. While there are many claims that superfoods have the power to prevent or even cure various diseases and ailments, consumers should be aware of truth versus false prophecies, prophecies. There is no one thing that cures all and fixes everything, and that's the key to what is falsified as the anti-aging movement, because we're all aging and we're all going to one day exit our body. It's that simple. But that is another topic for another day. Therefore, let's take a look at what constitutes a superfood and some foods that may fall into the category. According to the CDC, Center for Disease Control, more than 11% of the American diet comes from fast foods. That's pretty amazing. And public health research does emphasize that our diet is at the root of many of these modern diseases. A recent study done at Harvard, the School of Public Health at Harvard, was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, and that indicated that even small changes in the daily diet could improve health status and reduce the risk of chronic diseases. These minor changes, minor for some, but monumental for others, can be incorporating a nutrient-rich food diet into our routine, especially in America, where we're so deficient in our fruits and vegetables and our superfoods, quote-unquote. Superfoods, I'd rather say nutrient-rich foods, can play important roles in improving our health outcome. So we have to consider implementing these types of foods in our diet if we're going to have a nourished body and balanced mind. In other words, we're going to have resilience, which is translated into well-being. As I mentioned, what constitutes a superfood is a nutrient-rich food considered to be especially beneficial for our health and well-being. Perhaps the best definition we can use to describe a superfood is, how about a nutrient-dense, antioxidant-rich, organically grown food product that's minimally processed and bioavailable in numerous potent nutritive constituents? How's that? In other words, superfoods are natural foods, not GMO, not pesticides, not anything that's been modified or polluted with chemicals, that contain a hefty amount of raw nutrition and are highly active in various phytochemicals and the flavonoid compounds, which are antioxidants. For example, blueberries, they're considered always on the top of the list, but they're referred to as a superfood because of the low caloric density and the high antioxidant activity. But I'd like to add something to this. Not all blueberries are equal, and is anyone really considering this? We need to look at the environment for which the blueberries were grown. For example, wild blueberries that have been untouched by pesticides and herbicides, I don't even know if that exists on the planet, well, they'd have a different value than a commercially sprayed blueberry. dairy in general, and that takes common sense. But these are the things we have to really look at now, because the food chain is getting less and less as far as not being adulterated with pesticides and herbicides. We also must look at the soil, the growing process, hydration quality. What type of water is feeding these? Is it running off the mountaintop, which is clean, or is it running out of some industrial plant where there's many chemicals and pollutants? So we have to look at that, and also the harvesting process. It is well known that vegetables from the early 1900s have had a higher vitamin and mineral content than what we see today, because the soil was more plentiful. We had a better topsoil at that time. So keep it in mind when we're talking about superfoods or nutrient-based foods. There are literally thousands of known claims on superfoods and many more that are waiting to be discovered. But here are three of my personal superfoods, all of which have proven health benefits, and I'll show you what they are. I'll discuss them. My personal superfoods, if I were to take three, start with the mung bean. Mung beans have been used in Ayurveda as a staple legume source, and they are great. In fact, in my book, Feeling Good Matters, I provide a whole recipe of khichdi, which is an Ayurvedic recipe. I didn't make that up, because I believe so much in the mung bean, in its healing and sustainability of the organism. High source of vitamins and mineral are seen in mung beans, like folate and magnesium. Mung beans nutrition provide 100% of your daily value of folate in every 1 cup serving. Folate's also known as vitamin B9, and it's important for DNA synthesis, cell and tissue growth, hormonal balance, cognitive function, and even reproduction. In fact, consuming enough folate, and especially during pregnancy, has been considered an essential for pregnant women, preventing early births, neural tube defects, and even termination. So mung beans have all of that. Mung beans also provide about 36% of our daily magnesium needs for the average adult woman. Many adults are actually deficient in magnesium, which is unfortunate because most people really need a substantial amount in their diet in order to control stress levels and manage pain. And it's even good for our bone health. Magnesium is important for digestive health, proper heartbeat functioning, neurotransmitter release, and even repairing our muscle tissue when we're active. I even use it to help me with my sleep in the evening. So it's a great, great nutrient to consider. And mung beans have it. Mung beans were first domesticated in India, where they grew as wild plants. Archaeological evidence shows that mung beans were growing in the civilizations that the Punjab and the Haryana areas of India about 4,500 years ago, if you could imagine that. So they've been around for a while. Scholars separate the domestication of mung beans into two different species, the kind that grew in southern India, which was a larger seed that began to be harvested about 3,000 to 3,500 years ago, and an even older kind of mung bean that has smaller seeds that grew in northern India. And cultivated mung beans later spread from India into China and other parts of Southeast Asia. And records even show, you can tell I'm really into mung beans, that Thailand mung beans have been eaten for at least 2,200 years. Around the 9th or 10th century, mung beans also came to be cultivated in Africa, since they grow easily in warm climates and helped feed undernourished populations. Mung beans are most popular and widely grown today, as I mentioned, in India and China and Southeast Asia, and also in some parts of Southern Europe and the U.S. U.S. mung beans have been cultivated since around the 1830s or so, although they've really only picked up a following over the past decade or two due to the press. Today, about 75% or about 15 to 20 million pounds of mung beans are consumed in the U.S. every year, and they're imported and grown in India and China. Well, that's mung beans, and that is my favorite food and my go-to food for any type of healing and wellness. My next personal superfood is the beetroot. Beetroot is of exceptional nutritional value, especially the greens, which are rich in calcium, iron, vitamin A, and C. Beetroots are an excellent source of folic acid, and they're also a very good source of fiber, manganese, and potassium. These greens should not be overcooked. They can be cooked up and enjoyed the same way you would do spinach. because they have that same kind of sensitivity in the leaf. They're not as hard as, let's say, collards or kale. Beetroot is high in dietary nitrites, which actually support the endothelial function, which we call the blood flow, through the production of nitrous oxide. Consuming beets is actually crucial in improving our nitrous oxide production, and that supports our heart health. That's why I'm bringing it up. Beets also contain betaine, which also is known as trimethylglycine, which serves several functions, including acting as a methyl donor to modulate homocysteine. And we work with methyl donors and homocysteine when I'm working with people that suffer from either anxiety or depression. We use the B vitamins because they're methyl donors. So methylation is very, very important. Beetroot fiber has been shown to increase the number of white blood cells, which are responsible for detecting and eliminating abnormal cells. So red beetroots have been ranked as one of the top most potent antioxidant vegetables on the market, actually. And they're also one of the richest sources of glutamine. And that's an amino acid essential to the health and maintenance of our intestinal tract. Remember, you want the guts to be happy, you have to have a really good intestinal tract. Other studies have looked at the effect of beetroot juice on blood pressure, and there's studies that show a reduction in blood pressure, it being beneficial for the avoidance of heart disease and stroke, and many of you probably already know that, and beetroot juice has been effective in bringing down blood pressure. And so studies state that nitrate-rich foods like beetroot may help with heart attack survival. And you can look that up, and there's plenty of research out there. Moving on to my third choice of superfood is kale. Kale is today one of the most nutritionally important vegetables in the world because it possesses the highest levels of lutein of all vegetables contained in the USDA's database. And it's also belonging to important family of the cruciferous vegetables. Kale grows best in cooler climates. In fact, I grow it every year, and fall is the best time for harvest. It loves the cool weather, especially in the Mediterranean regions, but also in many other regions of the world, like my backyard and North America and throughout Europe. Currently, kale is available commercially, and it's been cultivated actually over thousands of years, gradually evolving from a wild-grown variety to the one that we know today. The most common type of kale found today is the species called Brassica, let me pronounce this, oleracea. So the Brassica oleracea, even though there are other species as well, that's the most common. And in terms of appearance, this kale leaves are, they appear flat, curly, with kale growing at about 6 feet in height. And colors include green, purple, and ornamental white and lavender varieties as well, if you can believe that. Kale originated in the Eastern Mediterranean and Asia Minor, where it was cultivated for food beginning in 2000 BC. The curly leaf varieties of the cabbage already existed along with the flat varieties of Greece in the 4th century BC. I did some history here because I'm always fascinated to see how long these types of vegetables have been around and, you know, how they might have changed. It was also used as a medicinal food source. These forms, which were referred to by the Romans, they were considered to be the ancestors of modern kale. Kale also is a source of phytochemicals, the carotenoids, lutein, and zeaxanthin. And as broccoli and other cruciferous vegetables, kale does contain glucosinolate, and they're compounds that contribute to the formation of sulfur compounds, and they're compounds that there's a lot of research done that affect human health. When we boil kale, it decreases the level of this compound, the glucosinate. Lots of biochemistry here. Whereas steaming or stir frying doesn't cause significant loss. I didn't put in, even though they say microwaving also allows it to keep its level of nutrients, but I'm not a fan of microwaving because I do believe it changes the inner structure on an organic level and changes the quality of its usage in the human organism. So I don't speak about it from the point of view of giving that as an option. Kale contains high levels of polyphenols, as I said, such as ferulic acid, with levels varying due to, again, environmental and genetic factors. You know, kale shares characteristics of many of the cruciferous family, including generous amounts of these natural antioxidants. And they include the common ones, such as the carotenoids, as well as vitamin C, but also some unique polyphenols and flavonoids. The reason why I'm bringing these up, all of these are considered, these words, polyphenols and flavonoids, in what we call superfoods. Two of these flavonoids, including quercetin and camphorol, which possess powerful antioxidant abilities, can help to buffer stress of free radicals. So this, in turn, can slow down premature aging, not aging, but premature aging, stress-induced aging, damage to the skin, as well as reducing our cardiac risk factors and possibly cancer risk. So including kale in your diet is a sure supplement. I would always recommend it for people because you get lots of vitamin A, vitamin C, K, calcium, manganese for very few calories. You could even make a batch of kale chips, which I do. You take the kale, you chop it up. I put it on a sheet and I bake it. I bake it at a low baking process. It probably destroys a lot of the vitamins and minerals, but what the heck? It's very enjoyable. And I do it with a little olive oil and some sea salt, and it tastes really, really great. You could also add it into a vegetable juice shake and salads. I don't like to mix vegetables and fruits in the same meal. With these three superfoods, keep in mind that they are only superfoods if they're grown in fertile and clean environments. The quality of seed, soil, and water, along with planting and harvesting practices, are what really make a food a superfood, because there is a deficit in nutrients when the soil is not rich and pesticides and herbicides are used. They're greatly diminished. That is what we're seeing now in the vegetables and fruits, and it's a real problem. The good news that it can be solved if we grow local, buy local, and use our dollar as a customer, demand foods that are not sprayed with glyphosate products like Roundup. Remember, glyphosate is a real killer in the soil. It destroys the microbiome, and in turn, it destroys the microbiome for feeding our own gut microbiome, which in turn feeds our neurotransmitters and in turn feeds the brain. So be aware, be a real aware consumer. Herbicides and pesticides are not what we need to be feeding our poor plants as well as ourselves, because everything comes back into whoever eats the plant. These products are designed to kill the herbicides and pesticides, and they certainly do. So get out and build your own garden bed and start by planting three of your favorite plants and make them your superfood. And you will be sure to have resilience, health, well-being. Anything positive will come to you. That brings me to the end of this episode on superfoods. If you'd like to be notified weekly for new podcasts, please subscribe. The Susan Taylor Podcast is available on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, and TuneIn, and also on susantaylor.org, where you can click on the podcast to subscribe. We're going to thank Shelley for this superfood suggestion, and you too can give us questions or comments, even feedback, by contacting me at susantaylor.org. And I'd like to say thank you all for listening. The Susan Taylor Podcast does come out every week. And again, until next time, remain calm, consciously aware, living in the moment. Take care, and I'll see you next week.